You have plenty of guys on the street that talk about capitalists and all them things, you know.
The police is the enemy. Everywhere the white man go, he bring misery. All throughout history, look it up. Everything them ball heads touch, they fuck it up. Every government he set up, it be corrupt.
Revolution.
Published April 28, 1899 by Springfield, Massachusetts, Weekly Republican. Negro burned alive in Florida. Second Negro then hanged. Noonan, Georgia, April 23, 1899. Sam Holt, the murderer of Alfred Cranford and the ravisher of the latter's wife, was burned at the stake, near Noonan, Georgia, this afternoon, in the presence of 2,000 people. The black man was first tortured before being covered with oil and burned. An ex-governor of Georgia made a personal appeal to his townspeople to let the law take its course, but without the slightest avail. Before the torch was applied to the pyre, the Negro was deprived of his ears, fingers and genital parts of his body. He pleaded pitifully for his life while the mutilation was going on, but stood the ordeal of fire with surprising fortitude. Before the body was cool, it was cut to pieces. The bones were crushed into small bits, and even the tree upon which the wretch met his fate was torn up and disposed of as souvenirs. The Negro's heart was cut into several pieces, as was also his liver. Those unable to obtain the ghastly relics direct paid their more fortunate possessors extravagant sums for them. Small pieces of bones went for 25 cents, and a bit of the liver crisply cooked sold for 10 cents. As soon as the Negro was seen to be dead, there was a tremendous struggle among the crowd, which had witnessed his tragic end, to secure the souvenirs. A rush was made for the stake, and those near the body were forced against it and had to fight for their freedom. Knives were quickly produced and soon the body was dismembered. One of the men who lifted the can of kerosene to the Negro's head is said to be a native of Pennsylvania. His name is known to those who were with him, but they refused to divulge it. The mob was composed of citizens of Noonan, Griffin, Palmetto and other little towns in the country round about Noonan, and of all the farmer who had received word that the burning was to take place. W.Y. Atkinson, a former governor of Georgia, met the mob as he was returning from church and he appealed to them to let the law take its course. In addressing the mob he used these words: "Some of you are known to me, and when this affair is finally settled in the courts, you may depend upon it that I will testify against you." A member of the mob was seen to draw a revolver and level it at Mr. Atkinson, but his arm was seized and the pistol taken from him. The mob was frantic with delays and would hear to nothing but burning at the stake. Before being put to death, the Negro is said to have confessed to killing Cranford, stating that he had been paid $20 by Elijah Strickland, a Negro preacher at Palmetto, for the deed. Holt was located in the little cabin of his mother on the farm of the Jones brothers between Macon and Columbus and brought to jail. Word was sent to Mrs. Cranford at Palmetto that it was believed Holt was under arrest and that her presence was necessary in Noonan to make sure of his identification. In some way the news of the arrest leaked out, and as the town has been on the alert for nearly 2 weeks, the intelligence spread rapidly. From every house in the little city came its occupants, and a good-sized crowd had soon gathered about the jail. Sheriff Brown was importuned to give up the prisoner, and finally, in order to avoid an assault on the jail and possible bloodshed, he turned the Negro over to the waiting crowd. A procession was quickly formed and the doomed Negro was marched at the head of the yelling, shouting crowd through several streets of the town. Soon the public square was reached. Here ex-Governor Atkinson of Georgia, who lives in Noonan, came hurriedly upon the scene, and standing up in a buggy importuned the crowd to let the law take its course. Governor Atkinson said, "My fellow citizens and friends, I beseech you to let this affair go no further. You are hurrying this Negro on to death without an identification. Mrs. Cranford, whom he is said to have killed, is sick in bed and unable to be here to say whether this is her assailant. Let this Negro be returned to jail. The law will take its course, and I promise you it will do so quickly and effectually. Do not stain the honor of the state with a crime such as you are about to perform." Judge A.D. Freeman of Noonan spoke in a similar strain and prayed the mob to return the prisoner to the custody of the sheriff and go home. The assemblage heard the words of the two speakers in silence, but the instant their voices had died away shouts of "On to Palmetto! Burn him! Think of his crime!" arose, and the march was resumed. Mrs. Cranford's mother and sister are residents of Noonan. The mob was headed in the direction of their house and in short time reached the McElroy home. The Negro was marched through the gate and Mrs. McElroy was called to the front door. She identified the African, and her verdict was agreed to by her daughter, who had often seen Holt about the Cranford place. "To the stake," was again the cry, and several men wanted to burn the Negro and Mrs. McElroy's yard. To this she objected strenuously, and the mob, complying with her wish, started for Palmetto. Just as they were leaving Noonan, news was brought that the 1 o'clock train from Atlanta would bring 1,000 people from Atlanta. This was to burn the prisoner at the first favorable place rather than be compelled to shoot him when the militia put in an appearance. Leaving the little town, whose Sunday quiet had been so rudely disturbed, the mob, which now numbered nearly 1,500 people, started on the road to Palmetto. A line of buggies and vehicles of all kinds, their drivers fighting for position in line, followed the procession, at the head of which, closely guarded, marched the Negro, 1.5 miles out of Noonan. A place believed to be favorable to the burning, was reached. A little to the side of the road was a strong pine tree. Up to this the Negro was marched, his back placed to the tree and his face to the crowd, which jostled closely about him. The clothes were torn from the Negro in an instant. A heavy chain was produced and wound around his body. He said not a word to this proceeding, but at the sight of the 3 or 4 knives slashing in the hands of several members of the crowd out about him, which seemed to forecast the terrible ordeal he was about to be put to, he sent up a yell which could be heard for a mile. Instantly a hand grasping a knife shot out and one of the Negro's ears dropped into a hand ready to receive it. He pleaded pitifully for mercy and begged his tormentors to let him die. His cries went unheeded. Palmetto, Georgia, April 24th. The body of Lynch Strickland, a Negro preacher, who was implicated in the Cranford murder by Sam Holt, was found swinging to the limb of a persimmon tree within 1.25 miles of Palmetto, Georgia early today. Before death was allowed to end the sufferings of the Negro, his ears were cut off and the small finger of his left hand was severed at the second joint. These trophies were in Palmetto yesterday. On the chest of the Negro was a piece of blood-stained paper, attached by an ordinary pin. On one side of this paper was written, "We must protect our ladies." The other side of the paper contained a warning to the Negroes of the neighborhood. It read as follows, "Beware all darkies. You will be treated the same way." Before being lynched, Strickland was given a chance to confess to the misdeeds of which the mob supposed him to be guilty, but he protested his innocence to the last. 3 times the noose was placed around his neck and the Negro was drawn up off the ground. 3 times he was let down with the warning that death was in store for him, should he fail to confess his complicity in the Cranford murder. 3 times Strickland proclaimed his innocence, until weary of useless torturing, the mob pulled the rope and tied the end around the slender trunk of the persimmon tree. Not a shot was fired. Strickland was strangled to death. The lynching of Lynch Strickland was not accomplished without a desperate effort on the part of his employer to save his life. The man who pleaded for him is Major W.W. Thomas, an ex-state senator, and one of the most distinguished citizens of Coweta County. He did all in his power to prevent the lynching of the Negro and did not discontinue his efforts until he had been assured by the leaders of the mob that the Negro would be taken to jail at Fairburn. 1 mile from the spot where this promise was made, Strickland was hanged. The Negro was a tenant on the plantation of Major Thomas. When Sam Holt, the murderer of Alfred Cranford and the assailant of his wife, made his confession immediately prior to his burning, he implicated Lynch Strickland, Holt contending that he had been offered money by Strickland to kill Cranford. It was known positively, however, that Holt had made false statements in his last confession, and many of those who aided in his burning were disposed to disregard his statement in regard to Strickland. About 15 men went to the plantation of Major Thomas late Sunday and took Strickland from his little cabin in the wood, and left his wife and 5 children to wait and weep over the fate they knew was in store for the Negro. The cries aroused Major Thomas, and a sturdy old man followed the lynchers in his buggy, accompanied by his son, Will Thomas, determined to save, if possible, the life of his plantation darky. They overtook the lynchers with their victim at Palmetto, and then ensued, with only the moonlight to brighten the faces of these grim men, a weird and dramatic scene. Lynch Strickland was halted directly opposite the telegraph office. The noose was adjusted around his neck and the end of the rope was thrown over the tree. Strickland was told he had a chance before dying to confess his complicity in the crime. He replied, "I have told you all I know, gentlemen. You can kill me if you wish, but I know nothing to tell. The Negro's life might have been ended then, but for the arrival of Major Thomas, who leaped from his buggy and asked for a hearing. He asked the crowd to give the Negro a chance for his life, and said, 'Gentlemen, this Negro is innocent. Holtz and Lige had promised to give him $20 to kill Alfred Cranford, and I don't believe Lige had $20 since he had been on my place. He has never done any of you any harm and I want you to promise me that he may be given a hearing. I do not ask you to liberate him. Hold him for the courts.' The mob replied that Strickland had inflamed the Negroes in the neighborhood and had a bad reputation, having run away from East Point several years ago. Major Thomas reminded the mob that the Negro had voluntarily told of having seen Holt on the night of the murder. One of the mob replied that Strickland had done this in cunningness of his guilt to establish his own innocence. There were some, however, who agreed with Major Thomas, and after a discussion, a vote was taken, which was supposed to mean life or death to Lige Strickland. The vote to let him live was unanimous. Major Thomas then retired some distance, and the mob was preparing to send Strickland in a wagon to Noonan, when a member of the mob cried out, "We have got him here, let's keep him." This aroused the mob and a messenger was sent to advise Major Thomas to leave Palmetto for his own good, but the old man was not frightened. He drew himself up and said emphatically, "I have never before been ordered to leave a town, and I am not going to leave this one." And then the major, uplifting his hand to give his words force, said to the messenger, "Tell them the muscles in my legs are not trained to running. Tell them I have stood the fire and heard the whistle of menace from 1,000 Yankee rifles, and I am not frightened by this crowd." Major Thomas was not molested, then, with the understanding that Lige Strickland was to be delivered to the jailer at Fairburn. Major Thomas saw the Negro and he had pleaded for let off to his death. The mob took the Negro to a grove near the home of Marshal Givens of Palmetto, and again the noose was adjusted. He was hauled off the ground, but was let down to allow him to confess. He refused to do so, and the lynchers were about to haul him up again when the son of Marshal Givens came upon the scene, and asked that the lynching should not occur near his father's home. The Negro was then taken to the yard in the rear of Dr. W.S. Zeller's home, and tied up to the persimmon tree and left hanging. A coroner's jury held an inquest over the body Monday afternoon and returned the usual verdict: death at the hands of parties unknown. Another mob is hunting the county for Albert Sewell, who has made himself obnoxious by remarks concerning the treatment given the Negroes by the whites. There is not much prospect of his capture, however, as he has had a day's start of his pursuers. Atlanta, Georgia, April 24. The Atlanta Constitution said this morning, "The terrible expiation which Sam Holt was forced to pay for his crime will arouse a flood of discussion carried on by those who know the facts in the near side and those who do not care for facts on the other. But while the form of his criminal's punishment cannot be upheld, let those who are disposed to criticize it look into the facts, and by these facts temper the judgment they may render. And it assuming, industrious and hard-working farmer, after his day's toil, sat at his evening meal. Around him sat wife and children, happy in the presence of the man who was fulfilling to them every duty imposed by nature, at peace with the world, serving God and loyal to humanity. They looked forward to the coming day." Noiselessly, the murderer with uplifted axe advanced from the rear and sank it to the hilt in the brain of the unsuspecting victim. Tearing the child from the mother's breast, he flung it into the pool of blood oozing from its father's wound. Then began the culmination, which has dethroned the reason of the people of Western Georgia during the past week. As critics will howl about the lynching, the Constitution will be pardoned for stating the plain facts. The wife was seized, choked, thrown upon the floor, where her clothing lay in the blood of her husband, and ravished. Remember the fact. Remember the dark night in the country home. Remember the slain husband. And above all, remember that shocking degradation which was inflicted by the black beast, his victim, swimming in her husband's warm blood as the brute held her to the floor. Keep the facts in mind. When the picture is painted of the ravisher in flames, go back and view that darker picture of Mrs. Cranford outraged in the blood of her murdered husband. Atlanta, George, April 24. Governor Candler of Georgia Sunday night gave the Associated Press the following statement on the burning of Sam Holt, near Noonan. "The whole thing is deplorable, and Holt's crime, the horrible details of which have been published and are too horrible for publication, is the most diabolical in the annals of crime. The Negroes of the community lost the best opportunity they will ever have to elevate themselves in the estimation of their white neighbors, but they lost the opportunity, and it is a deplorable fact that, while scores of intelligent Negroes, leaders of their race, have talked to me about the Palmetto lynching, not one of them has ever in the remotest way alluded to the diabolical crime of Holt which provoked the lynching. I do not believe these men sympathized with Holt, but they can see but one side of the question and are blinded by race prejudices." If Esau is not the devil, then who and where is he?
When the people learn the truth about the system, the cities will burn, and I stand firm like Shaka Zulu. These crackers can't stop you, hoo-hoo. This is what we've been waiting for. 21st century still poor. World war they want me to kill for. What happened to the future they always predicted? With new science, fictional things, and space visits. I seen two sides, us against them. Police troops riding with 4 to 5 men. Prison business is booming. Senators.